Welcome to the Social Engineer Podcast. This is the Human Element Series, episode 234. I'm Chris Hadnagy, CEO and founder of Social Engineer LLC, the Innocent Lives Foundation, and the Institute for Social Engineering. And I've been hosting this podcast since back in 2009, and we just established I still don't know what I'm doing. So welcome to the show. Okay, a couple quick announcements before we get to our amazing guests. First of all, as always, these episodes are sponsored by our company, Social Engineer. A lot of you have been asking about our training schedule, so it is finally up there for 2024. Check it out. We're going to be adding things to it all the time, but we have some foundational classes now in Orlando. We have a practical class, our first one, not virtual. You can find that on the schedule. That will be live somewhere up in the Northeast. And we have our MLSE class, master's level class, scheduled also. And as we announced last year, or this year, yeah, I guess we're still in this year, it's not last year yet, that we are opening that up to the public instead of being invite only. So you can find all of those dates and information about the training schedule on the website, social-engineer.com. So go check that out. If you're an enthusiast and you like the topic of social engineering, or you want to learn more about it, maybe you're just getting into the field, or you want to see how you can get in the field, you should definitely be in our Slack channel. It's a family-friendly, free place to come and talk. So if you're looking for a place to do that and be family-friendly and have legal discussions, okay, I make that a priority because we had some problems, then get the link in the show notes. If you can't find it, hit me up on LinkedIn. I'll get it for you. We have about, I think, 1,500 people in there now every day talking about all aspects of social engineering. And we even have a job board where I think about 10 people found employment now because of posting that they're looking for work or that companies are looking to hire. So come on in if you're looking for anything to do with social engineering or the InfoSec industry. And I also want to invite everyone who's listening to take a moment to go visit InnocentLivesFoundation.org. If you're not familiar with the mission over there, it's a nonprofit that I started over 6 years ago. And our mission is to work closely with law enforcement to help geolocate and track people who traffic children and create child abuse material. And I'm really proud to say that as of this podcast, actually before this podcast, we have hit our 500th case. So we've handed in 500 cases to law enforcement all around the globe where we've helped identify either single, alone child predators or groups or trafficking groups and networks and have them geolocated, totally targeted, and then hand them off to law enforcement so they can be apprehended and shut down. I cannot be prouder of the team over there and all the things that they are doing and that we are doing together. So if you want to find out more, you can go to InnocentLivesFoundation.org. There's a lot of information if you're a caregiver or a parent on how to talk to your kids about these things, how to keep your kids safe on the internet. That's something that we all need nowadays. But if you want to support us, you can do that by volunteering if that's something you want to do, or you can donate. Of course, as we're a nonprofit, a 501c3, all the information is on InnocentLivesFoundation.org. And if you like the music that opens up this podcast, then it's none other than the best rock and roll band on earth, Clutch. Go check them out at pro-rock.com. Neil's a huge fan. I'm a huge fan of Neil and the band there, and he has helped start ILF and was a big supporter for many, many years. So let's give them some love and listen to their music too. Okay, last but not least, if you have any comments, questions, you want a topic that you want to see on this series of the Social Engineer Podcast, put it down in the comments. Give us a thumbs up and a like. That helps us spread the message everywhere. And as you know, we love taking any of your suggestions for guests or for topics or ideas. So give it to us and we will gladly do that. Let's get to our guest, Laura Casselman, the CEO of JVZoo.com and co-founder of Vidastreet LLC. Laura has climbed the corporate ladder by mastering the rules of the old boys club, something we're going to really want to talk about on this series, isn't it? More often than not, she beat them at their own game, and she's been published in Inc. magazine, Entrepreneur, and her book, which we'll talk about, called Trust Your Increments, and it's a Wall Street Journal bestseller, which is something really, really awesome to achieve, by the way. Laura's companies have been featured in Inc. 5000's list of America's fastest growing companies 4 times. Laura, that sounds really, really impressive. Thank you for being here with us today.
Thank you for having me.
So let's start off with just the basic question I ask everybody. How did you get to here? How was this your path to what all these amazing things we just said? How did that become you?
Well, it was definitely not a straight line. I have a previous career as a professional dancer on Broadway. I was a Radio City Rockette. And that was what I always wanted to be since I was 3 years old. I was going to go to New York, dance with the Rockettes. And really, as a child, that was my goal. I wasn't thinking, what was I going to do afterwards? But there were signs along the way that for others that were paying attention would say I would likely run companies.
That is an interesting path. Okay. I don't know if I would have ever guessed that you start off as a rocket and now you're Inc. Magazine's one of fastest growing companies in America 4 times. Okay. So that's interesting. At what point did you say, okay, I'm going to do more than, and not that being a rocket is a bad career, but you said, I'm going to do more than that and I'm going to go start companies and run companies.
So there was never a point that I wasn't doing more. In fact, even my first dance gigs, I started dancing professionally at the age of 16. So I was doing my dance performance jobs and going to school and then college and my dance performance jobs. But I, along the way, did sales jobs, and I include the Girl Scout cookie sales as a sales job. It was very serious to
me.
Oh,
yeah. No, that's a sure. That is a, those girls are hard workers, I tell you.
Right?
They are hard workers.
But always I was doing other things. Even when I was dancing at theme parks, I was offering my cast members to fix their credit scores. I was like, oh, do you have a bad credit score? I can help you with that. So I just was always doing other things and kind of taking lead at protecting the people around me and saying, oh, that's a big mistake. That can follow you for 7 years. You know, like those types of things. And by the time I was a rocket, I was already working in corporate America at a lower level, of course. And I would do the Radio City Christmas Spectacular for 3 months out of the year, and then jump right back into corporate America when I was done. And I just would go back and forth. And I found that the companies I worked for in New York City would allow me to leave and go dance with the Rockettes each year because I would smash my goals when I would come back. And each year I came back to a promotion. So when I finally said, I'm done with dance, it's time for me to retire, hang up my Rockette high heels, I stepped into my first executive position.
Wow.
So it seemed like a big transition from the outside, but from the inside, I was dual resuming the entire time.
Yeah. So you were already building that empire. So it was easy for you just to step into the C-level role when you left dancing. That's fascinating. So was this a plan for success? Is that even possible? Is that something you had written out?
So I am a planner and I write lots of plans. When I was younger, maybe had less confidence in my own abilities, I didn't just have plan A, I had plan B. And if B goes wrong, here's C and D, maybe an E. I was a thorough planner. Now I usually have a really thorough plan A and know that if I need to pivot or find a new direction last minute, I can always do that.
That's an interesting concept. So I want to ask something extra on that. What was the change? Like where before you had A through F and now you just said A, but I can pivot. What happened in your life or in your thought process or in your successes that you said, I'm just going to stick with A and pivot instead of having 15 plans?
Simple experience. Doing it over and over again. You know, people will note and have my entire life how confident I am, but confidence comes in different levels and you become confident and your own abilities, the more times you repeat certain actions. And so experience leads to more confidence in your own self and knowing that no matter what comes, I will be okay.
Yeah, that's a fascinating thought process. You wrote something about how good leaders are always firing themselves. Why, tell me more about that. I've not heard that kind of statement before, so it's kind of new for me. So I'm interested in what you mean by that.
Yes. So I live by a rule of firing myself every 90 days. And I believe that all good leaders should do this. And what that means is that if you are doing a task more than one time, you should be documenting it. Once you have documented a task, it means it's trainable to someone else. You should be training someone else to take that task off of your plate so that you free up mind space and energy for you to continue leading the company and looking for growth opportunities. A lot of times, especially in small businesses, it is the owner or the executive that becomes the bottleneck of the company. So good leaders fire themselves every 90 days and pass off tasks that can be trained to others.
Okay, so that's an interesting concept. And I now you're like you're making all sorts of questions for me. And I feel like I'm now in a therapy session. So let me ask you a further question on that. So you're documenting your tasks and, you know, not every task can be handed off. There are some things you have to do, but you say, okay, here's these 10 things that I repeated for the last 90 days, and five of them could be handed off. And you look at your company and you say, okay, I'm going to give this person this task and train them. What do you do if either there's signs that that person really can't handle that task, or they just don't have the desire or the motivation to do it? Then what do you do at that point?
So then I think that's a staffing issue. One, you have to know what your staff is capable of, but also your staff has to be willing and wanting to take on more and grow. Compensate properly as well. You can't disrespect your team. And I don't believe in that, but I do believe that growth opportunities should be available. Higher pay levels should be available. And as I'm handing off, especially for me, if I'm handing off to my COO, then there shouldn't be too big of a discrepancy between what that person can handle and what I'm already doing. But a lot of times I'm taking a task and handing it much further down than the COO. I'm actually, if I need to look for someone new for that position and say, ah, we've started this new area in our company, I'm going to do the things first because I like to know how to do everything in the company. There are certain tasks I cannot do, but I like to do as much as possible so that I can later say, we're doing that wrong, or we can improve on it if we tweak this. So when I'm doing those things, I'm documenting them, and then I train, and then I say, I want feedback from the person I train. Give me feedback. What am I missing? What do you think we could do better? Let's test that.
I love that theory. I'm the same way in the sense that I had to make sure I can do every job in the company that I would give to someone else. And we, I was reflecting on when you said that about two and a half, maybe 3 years ago, we hired this amazing VP of sales. And when he came in, I realized I didn't know anything about selling because he's so good. And I'm like, oh man, I thought I was doing a good job. And this guy comes in and he's just, you know, he's phenomenal. And I'm like, okay, I got nothing to teach you. You know, you're the man, you go do it. You teach me, you know?
Absolutely. We definitely want to hire people that fill in our gaps, right? And that are better in areas that are our weaknesses. But also as leaders, when we do these other jobs or even try to do them, it creates more respect. We don't forget the value of that position and why we need that person or that position on our team.
Yeah. Okay. I want to switch gears to a different topic. At my company here, I think we're a little over 50% women on our workforce, and hearing some of their stories, coming from other places, it's a little shocking and scary. Mainly because I don't think until recently many of us even realized how bad it was for women in the workforce, if unless you were a woman in the workforce. For many of us, it was with the movements, the Me Too movements, that we started hearing these horrific stories, and then, you know, you hear it from your employees and places they came. So how do we address this systematic sexism that's happening in the workplace without making everybody feel uncomfortable?
So one is making it part of the conversation, but not making it a everybody sit down and here's a lecture. And if we just look to respect and respecting one another in the workplace, it's natural. It's a lot more natural, should I say. For some people, because of systemic sexism, and this isn't just for men, this is women too, we are also guilty. Awareness. So a lot of times, if we just discuss things openly, people become more aware and will self-reflect on that and think, oh, I've done that before. And I didn't ever intend for that to be the feeling or the emotion that I placed on that person. For me, it was constantly seeing other people be treated disrespectful. And then when it started happening to myself, when someone in a meeting would interrupt me and say, oh, I think what she's trying to say is, well, I was saying it until you interrupted me. And then thinking back to the times that I didn't simply say, if you'd allow her to finish, it's not rude. We're not being disrespectful to anyone else in return. We're just saying, hey, if you'd allow her to finish, she would say what she's trying to say. So the more we talk about things openly so that people can think about experiences that they may have witnessed, that they could then just say something very simple to end, it doesn't become uncomfortable. It just becomes more commonplace.
So how would you suggest in a place maybe that, you know, they're hearing this and they're thinking, boy, we do need to have these discussions. How do they even start it? Like, how do they, without doing what you said, like, everyone sit down, we're having a corporate meeting, we're talking about sexism, you know, I mean, that's going to make everyone uncomfortable. So how do you even, what's your suggestion to even just get it going so people feel comfortable having this conversation?
So I think it's twofold. It's one, you want to let the people in your company know it, like in particular, if it's sexism, the women in your company know we have witnessed some things. We're going to begin addressing them. We'd like to review with you some things that you are able to say back, you know, in a non-confrontational tone, simply repeat back. So we want to practice with you standing up for yourself. And we want you to know we've got your back. Because a lot of times women, we've been conditioned to think if I speak up, I'm now the problem. And I will say I experienced that firsthand in some companies when I was in New York City and actually in my first executive position. I could not believe it. I had a moment where I thought, I've arrived, you know, like I'm an executive in New York City. Yeah. Like I'm something. I've come from my small one stoplight town. Look at me. And it resulted in the owner of the company stopping my direct deposit, scheduling me to meet for my paycheck. The meetings were always at a restaurant at the bottom of a hotel, and then eventually asking me for sexual favors in exchange for my paycheck. And I remember standing up for myself, making a big scene, actually threw water in his face, stormed out of the restaurant. And for a half a second, I felt so proud of myself. And then in the next moment, I thought, I'm unemployed. I don't have a job. I just quit my first executive position. I wasn't even there a year. I may have just made myself unhirable. And like it was, I just was deflated. And I was so fortunate that that wasn't my path. But I know many women that don't want to be the problem. So if a company just says, we've seen these things, here's some ways you can stand up for yourself. We have your back and we will be addressing them with individuals as well.
That story sadly is not shocking, but it's still disheartening. You know, thinking about here, we had, fortunately we have a really good team here and everyone does feel comfortable talking, but we had a female employee that came to me and said that a client, was very inappropriate with her and was making sexual comments during a meeting that they had. And, I was like, what? Like, no, I've been in my head, I'm thinking, but I've been in a million meetings with this guy. He never seemed like that. And I'm like, so I said to her, tell me what he said. And when she described it, it was appalling. And it wasn't even that it was foul language. It was so inappropriate, hinting at sexual during a meeting where you're talking about the services that we offer. And she's going over like a report and talking about like, this is what it means. And here's what we're going to do next month. And then he's making innuendos and suggestions. And I'm like, he never did that when I was there, of course, or when any other male member was there. He only did that when they were in a meeting alone. And we had, you know, we went right to his boss in the company and said, we don't work with him anymore. So assign somebody else. Or, you know, get rid of them, but we're not working with them anymore. And I remember, I mean, not anywhere near the same what happened to you. I thought, well, we just lost the client. Mm-hmm. and we did eventually. We lost that client. But, as bad as that is, I'd rather lose a client than put somebody in a meeting where they're going to feel like that every time. I mean, just the fact that happens so often. So, you know, I was leading to a thought like in that situation with you, you stood up to the guy who had all the power. Mm-hmm. And in our situation, the same. And then we lost that client. So what do people do when they don't have, I mean, you know, like in your work, you know, talking about to women that may be in that same situation, where do they go if the person that is now doing this is the one in power and there is no winning for them?
So that's a difficult situation, one. And the first thing I would say is, one, if you feel you may be in physical danger, you just have to leave.
Yeah.
Right? Leave first, protect yourself first, and then we figure out the rest after that. The other thing is if you're not in physical danger, but you know you're being disrespected and it's not going to get better, then you have to start looking for another job. We spend so much of our lives at work. We cannot hate our jobs. We don't have to love them. Sometimes we just work to get money to do the things we love, and that's fine. But you cannot put yourself in a situation where you are uncomfortable, you feel disrespected every single day, and you just have to start looking. And when that time comes, I am not a believer in not turning in a notice, but there are some people that do not deserve your 2 weeks. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's great suggestions. That's some powerful stuff. And, I'm assuming that you've had to build this over your your careers that you've had, because you've experienced this sadly enough that you've had to, like you said, write out your plan on what's going to happen if this ever happens to you again.
And so, I still do experience it, but one, I'm in a position where I can protect my team, and I do what you all just did. If someone puts a team member of mine in a bad situation, we don't need that client. But I sometimes will discuss it with them, and I'll say, this is exactly why. And I have also gone reverse roles. I had a female client that was sending pictures, unsolicited photographs to an employee of mine. And I had to speak to the CEO and president of her company to say, hey, we aren't going to continue this working relationship, but I want to let you know why. Because it's not just men, it is women too, but it's the more we talk about these things, and as a society, the more we say this is unacceptable, the more we train our youth that it's unacceptable and to stand up for themselves. And you don't have to be angry in standing up for yourselves. You can simply say, no, or I am speaking now, please let me finish, or whatnot in the situation. But it's important we train on those things. Mm-hmm.
That's a really powerful point. I didn't think about that. And in setting this example, our children can see how to defend themselves properly. And I really love what you said, without anger, because I'm sure for you it's the same. I do, when we talk about this, I feel angry. Telling that story about my female employee, I still feel angry. I got angry saying it for her, but then reaction and anger is not going to fix the problem, and it makes people defensive. So that's a really powerful point, to not do it in anger and use it as a training mechanism for young people, because they're now dealing with this. I mean, we're seeing reports come in as young as 8 or 9 years old with being exploited. So our younger and younger kids, because we're all on the internet nonstop and have devices, they're having to deal with these very, very adult situations. So what a nice thought, and using that as training for our kids. Thank you for that. That was really, really powerful.
Great.
Okay. So this is a heavy one, heavy topic that we went to, but I think it's really important. So I appreciate that. And I want to kind of bring it back around now to something you talked about with mindset, like the mindset of winning and succeeding. But how do people get their mindset there if they're, I don't want to say if they're not, but you know, like you have some self-doubts, or you're looking in the mirror and saying, no, you're not, I'm not Laura. Like, I'm not going to be her. I'm not going to be able to do that. How do we change that mindset?
So I mentioned earlier, as we were talking about how I no longer have plans B to E, I only have plan A, and I believe in myself. I trust in my abilities. So for people that don't believe in themselves enough yet, they're not confident in their own abilities, my suggestion would be to make your plan and then start checking off your daily checklist towards achieving your plan. Because your confidence muscle is like any other muscle in your body. You need to work it out frequently to not only grow strong, but to stay strong. And the more confident you become, that's a mindset thing, right? It's an adjustment of saying, I have proven to myself that I can do this. I see all over now on social media that real leaders don't take cheap dopamine hits. Well, I don't agree with that. I say we don't take cheap dopamine hits that are bad for us. But there are plenty of cheap dopamine hits that are good for us. Including just smiling and being smiled back. That is a cheap dopamine hit that I'll take all day long.
Yeah.
Seeing my daughter smile at me, whew, I'm telling you, I'm ready for the day now.
Yeah.
But with my checklist, every day I sit down and I have my to-do list for the day at work. And each item I check off, cheap dopamine hit that motivates me to do the next step. And I always eat the frog first. So when I get rid of those hard to do or uncomfortable, difficult items, instantly I'm like, I do 5 more things. Those dopamine hits fuel me throughout the day. At the end of the day, I see my completed checklist and I know what I'm capable of doing again tomorrow.
I love that. You know, I agree. Sometimes you go on social media, which is where we're all at, and you're looking for leadership tips. And a lot of them, I read them and I'm like, oh boy, I'm glad I didn't get told that one when I was starting out, because that seems counterproductive to everything that I've learned in my time trying to achieve business, you know? So, and I'm with you on the dopamine hits, not the ones that are bad for us, but yeah, starting the day off with hugging your loved ones or hearing somebody say something nice to you, I'll take that all day long, right? Why not?
And I was just at an event where I was giving a speech, and I pivoted for a moment just to say, like, I gamify everything. It's my personality. I like to win. So for me, I'm like, from the moment I get up, if I can get up the first time my alarm goes off, I'm like, killing it, Laura.
Yeah.
You know, I'm at my own internal cheerleader. No one else is supposed to be my cheerleader. Self-encouragement, inside job. So I believe in that. If I make it to the coffee pot and pour a cup of coffee and get a sip before my three-year-old wakes up, winning. If I don't, but my healthy three-year-old wakes up and calls me, I'm still winning.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I play things for me, because I am a person that likes to win. So yeah. I like to play the game. But, you know, you do what works for you.
Yeah.
And you do the things that help you see your own abilities, because we are all so incredibly capable.
I really love that. It's a great message. I never thought about the little wins, right? Because I do that all the time. I get up before the alarm and I never thought of it as a win. You know, I'm just like, I'm always like, oh man, I woke up before the alarm. So,
well, coming from theater, my world was at night. Right. I danced late at night. I performed in shows. And then when everybody else would go home and go to bed, I would hang out with the theater people. So it was very hard for me to fully transition and love working in the corporate world, or even as a mom getting up at the crack of dawn. We all know that toddlers do these things.
Yeah.
And when I just kind of reframed my mindset, then I was able to change it to, this is something to look forward to. So just the other night, I didn't get to sleep. I just had one of those nights where for some reason I could not sleep. And I had just fallen asleep. I had just gotten into a deep sleep. And my daughter wakes up at 5 a.m.
Oh.
And I had a second where I was like, oh my gosh, this is awful. How am I going to get through the day? And then I learned something recently called a power pause, where I took a moment. I paused. I directed my attention to the positive. So it was intentional, the way I directed my intention. And I learned this from Jeanette Bonnet, by the way. And I was like, wow. Instantly, I was reframed to say, I get an extra hour with my daughter today. Hmm. How incredible.
Hmm. That's really nice. I love that. I love the reframing. It's really good. Yes. So tell me about your company. That's JVZoo.com. Tell me about that. What do you guys do there?
Yeah. So I am the CEO of JVZoo. I don't own that company. It's an affiliate network and an online marketplace that has grown organically for 12 years and now has over 1 million affiliates.
Wow.
So, pretty good word of mouth there.
Yeah, I'd say.
Pretty proud of it. And we want to make sure that we understand our users' business. We want to make sure that we are providing the things that they need and as their businesses grow, and mostly that we provide amazing customer support and they know that we care about them. Mm. We have a great synergy as well. We don't make money unless our users make money. So we're all in it together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love it. Sounds great. And then what about Vidastreet? Tell me about that. You've co-founded that.
Yes. Vidastreet, I co-founded with a gentleman that used to be a JVZoo user, met him speaking at an event in Portugal and said, wow, I see what you're doing and how you're making a lot of other people a lot of money, but you're not making any for yourself. I'd like to help you with that.
That was very nice of you.
I like to recognize talent and to help it out. So we have worked together to build an advertising agency that we're pretty proud of now.
Oh, that's really awesome. And is marketing and advertising something that you either studied or have expertise in, or like what made you go that direction?
Not at all. It is not my expertise. I run businesses and I'm very good at doing that. And I recognize talent and I said, let me help you make money for yourself.
Wow. Okay. I love it. That's really great. Okay. And then your book, Trust Your Increments. Can we tell me about that? What made you write that? What's the message? Would love to know.
So I started writing Trust Your Increments because I consult with a lot of companies and I kept finding myself repeating the same information that seemed very basic to me, but I was saying it over and over again. And sometimes we forget how easy it is now to start businesses. Anyone can start a business now, and we have with our mobile devices and our laptops the ability to go online and register a corporation and get started immediately.
Yeah.
Or to go to a website like Shopify and set up a storefront without a lot of work. And so many times people didn't learn business the hard way, like a lot of us did in the past. So I started typing up the information I was consistently sharing in an effort to make my own life easier and not to retype over and over again or have the same conversations over and over again and simply to say, you should read this and then we'll talk about it. When I was done, I thought, I've got a lot of information here. I'm going to maybe turn this into a book. Sent it out for feedback and got the same thing repeatedly from a lot of women that I'd asked for their feedback. And that was, how can you talk about all these great things with business and not address the elephant that is in our room, which was what we spoke about earlier. Mm-hmm. The things we've all had to overcome. But for a lot of them, they notice that I have a positive mindset and they're like, you know, how have you done it? And you're still joyful and happy. Mm. So we reframed a lot of the book, worked on it, included real stories that happen in the workplace and what women face and or men as well, and how we need to change that game. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the point of the book, why we wrote it, put it out there. And it's about playing the game by the rules until you can change the rules.
That's really amazing. And we're going to put a link to it in the show notes if anyone's interested in reading that book. Thank you so much, Laura. This has been a wonderful conversation, but I have a couple questions that I always ask in the end. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't be sitting here today without a few great people, a few great mentors, you know, and when I think about anything that I've been able to achieve, there's just some of those people always come to mind. Who would you say is your greatest mentor or mentors?
It's so hard because as we develop in life, we kind of have to go to other people for new answers and new guidance. Yeah. But I would say my parents, if it's the one consistent, because my father taught me about running a business, honoring your word and having integrity in business. And my mother taught me about how you don't have to know everything as long as you know how to find the answers. And that carries through consistently in life. So they gave me a solid foundation, and I'm just so fortunate to have had them as my parents.
That's great. That's really nice. I love that. And besides your book, which of course we'll put in the show notes, it doesn't have to be about any topic that we talked about. It just, do you have a book that you love that you said, I want to share this with everyone because they need to read it?
So first of all, I love so many books. I'm a big reader. And since my daughter was born, I take her like to the section of my house with all the books and I say, we're going to read all the books. because I think, wow, there's so much knowledge right at our fingertips all the time and people's stories. It's really hard, but I want to say, how much time do you have? Let me tell you a million of them.
I'll take a few. It's fine.
I'm going to talk about, if you don't mind, two.
Okay.
And they are things we talked about. One is by Lanny Grasham, who is an Olympic winner. I've even got it big with me with Winning in Mind. And I think it's incredible. A friend of mine recommended it. It's about mental management. And the other one, same exact type of thing, but it's called Winning the Moment. And this one's incredible as well because it kind of gives you a blueprint. How do we get started? How do we know what matters to us and make every moment a winning moment? Mm-hmm.
That's wonderful. I love those. And I've never had those suggestions on any other show. So I love it when I get new books. You know, sometimes when you ask this question, people have like, you get some of the same books, right? But I've never had either of those suggested. So that will be some new ones to the list for everyone who's listening. For 13 years of doing this, we have a reading list. So on our website, once we put the podcast out, we grab all the books that have been recommended and we put them in a list. So people always say, well, what do you like to read? And it's like, well, here it is. Here's our reading list. And
that's so cool.
Yeah. A lot of our listeners love to read, or they do audio books. Mm-hmm. I'm a huge reader too. My library is everything I've ever read. And I don't tend to get rid of books. Like, I know a guy who reads them and then after he keeps them for a couple of years, he passes them on. I'm like a hoarder or something. I keep every book I have.
And you know, it's so funny. I will dog ear pages and otherwise abuse books. But when I was a broke college student and I couldn't afford books, I had $100 and I spent like $98 on a coding book, a programming book. And I would take it home, read it real fast, write all the notes down, and I'd go exchange it for the next one. And I did it for months until one day in Greensboro, North Carolina, the Barnes & Noble manager pulled me to the side and said, I know what you're doing. And I was like, feeling so guilty, but as a broke college student.
Right.
And he says, But you don't break the spines in my books. So I'm going to let you keep doing it.
Wow. What a nice guy.
What a nice guy.
Yeah.
Who knew that a dance major was going to one day run a tech company and was reading all these coding books?
I mean, man, wouldn't that be cool if you ever could find out who that guy was?
Yeah. I mean, when I mention it randomly, I hope one day he's like, I remember that.
Right. That was me. Right. No, so I do the same thing. So like all my books I have, like I'm reading this one right now, but I put a pen in each one. Mm-hmm. Right. And then I write notes in the columns or I highlight. Yeah. So I don't want to pass this on. This has my notes or something like personal to myself. Right. So it's like,
you can always buy another copy and send it to someone.
That's true.
That as well.
Yeah.
And a lot of times we forget too that when people write these books, there's not a ton of money in books anymore,
no.
But like every book sale matters. So when you get a great book and you know it's great, buy it for a friend.
Yeah. I love that. That's great. Yeah. Gifting a book. We do that often. I love doing that. So if people want to know more about you or find out like where you're speaking, what's the best place for them to connect?
So my website, lauracasselman.com, okay. Or you can go on Instagram, thelauracasselman.com.
Okay. Okay. We'll put links to both of those in the show notes too. Laura, I cannot thank you enough. You are definitely right when you say you have a positive outlook. Just talking with you, I feel happier. So thank you for making that the beginning of my day really great. Yeah. Really appreciate that. And thank you all for joining us this month on this great episode. And we'll be back next month with another amazing guest. Until then, see ya and stay safe.